So here's the question that I have for you today and really this year. How do we learn to live within the kingdom of God that actuates heaven on earth? Well, Jesus already actuated it. He brought the kingdom of God here. It's here. But we can learn how to live in this new environment. We can kind of appropriate ourselves to live in this environment. So here's something I'm very excited about. I feel like the Lord gave me an acronym that are four action steps. The acronym is READ, R-E-A-D. And this is how we are going to read through Matthew. This is how we're going to appropriate ourselves into this environment of the kingdom of God, okay? So the R stands for READ. Number one, we're going to read the words of the king, okay? If you want to know how to live life in the kingdom of God, well, let's read the words of the king. Jesus said, "My words are spirit and life," okay, in John 6:63. And so what this means is that Jesus is more than a historical figure, okay? He is a living person. So we don't ask who was Jesus, we ask who is Jesus. He is a real, reigning, living person. This also means that his words are not just ancient text, they are spirit and life. And so this means that as we read his words and as we apply them, there are spiritual ramifications that brings life and vitality to our souls, okay? Life to our mental health, life to our emotional health, life to our relationships, life to our vocation, right? Life in our whole lives. Jeremy opened up today with Jesus' words. He said, "Anyone who hears my words and puts them into practice is like a man who builds his house on a firm foundation, that when the storms of life come, that house stands." Okay, well, reading the words of Jesus is a great way to start that process, okay? So if you want to know what life in the kingdom of God is like, well, you must begin by reading the words of the king. Number two, the E stands for emulate. Okay, we're going to emulate the life of the king. You know, Jesus was a perfect prototype human, and he had no sin whatsoever. He was a perfect prototype human. And I think it's fascinating that Jesus, being a perfect human with no sin, found it necessary to pray more than anyone. Okay, and if Jesus needed to depend on the Father through prayer every day, how much more do we, as fallen, sinful humanity, need to depend on the Father? And so, what was Jesus' spiritual life like? How did he worship? How did he rely on God? One example is he was in the wilderness fasting from food for 40 days to strengthen his dependence on God. And he was being tempted to give up and to eat. Satan was tempting him, and he said this. He said, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." And so this proved true, because as he fed on God's word, it literally sustained his physical body for 40 days. Okay, so we want to emulate his life. We want to pray the way that he prayed. We want to worship the way that he worshiped. We want to lead in our communities the way that he led. We want to serve how he served. We want to love other people the way that he loved. And we want to disciple people the way that he discipled. And we're going to get to the end, and we're going to see Matthew 28. He tells us to give our lives to influencing and discipling other people. So if you want to know the life in the kingdom of God, what it's like, you need to read the words of the king, and you need to emulate the life of the king. Number three, the A stands for apply. We need to apply the commands of the king. And I love this verse in Leviticus 26, 3 and 4. Look at these words. It says, "If you follow my decrees and you're careful to obey my commands, I will send rain in its season, and the ground will yield its crops and trees their fruit." And so you see a very unique connection here between obedience and abundance. Okay, as we obey Jesus' commandments, we experience life more abundantly. Now, you may be like, hey, this is an Old Testament passage, okay? We're under grace now. Well, I want you to know that this principle created by God still exists. We were at staff meeting, and Frank read this verse and was sharing the meaning of this verse. And I asked him to give a little bit of verbiage to me because it was so good, and I wanted to share it with you. And I'll share a little quote from him, but I'm going to kind of set it up. He explained that the Jews were Jews because of God. They can't make themselves Jews. They were in a relationship with God. They couldn't earn it. It was all something that God had done. But he said that the commandments were guidelines. They were directives that would, if obeyed, place them in a channel of blessing. He explains that they couldn't control their relationship with him, but they did have maximum control over their blessing. And he said every decision they made put them on a trajectory that would end up in that channel of blessing. And he said this very succinctly, grace is offered and given without regard to merit, so it is unconditional. However, being in the channel of blessing is contingent upon obedience. Frank Anderson, everybody. So grace is unmerited. However, blessing flows from obedience. When we live within the perimeters of God's moral framework, there is blessing. One verse I read in my Bible reading this week that I thought said this so perfectly is 1 Corinthians 7:35. Look at this. Paul says, I say this for your own benefit, not to lay restraint upon you, but to promote good order and secure your undivided devotion to the Lord. I love that. So the commandments of Jesus are for your own benefit. They are to promote good order in your life and to secure your undivided devotion to the Lord. It's not to put restraints on you. I heard somebody say one time, I am not a Christian, or I don't believe in Christianity because you guys place expectations on people that they cannot achieve. And the reality, it's actually the opposite. Okay, Jesus said, take my yoke upon you. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. I want you to know that if the Christian life to you is a burden, you're not wearing the yoke of Jesus. Okay, you're wearing a yoke of a completely different gospel. So if you want to know what life in the kingdom of God is like, well, you need to read the words of the king, you need to emulate the life of the king, and you need to apply the commandments of the king. And if you will do this, number four, you will delight in the presence of the king. Okay, the D stands for delight. When we get to the end of the year in Matthew 28, Jesus actually says, go make disciples of all nations, or learners of me. To all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Teach them to observe all that I have commanded you. And then he says this, and I will be with you to the very end of the age. Now, the presence of Jesus was actually given for devotion, but also for disciple making. Okay, in Acts 1:8, he poured out his spirit and he said, go be my witnesses. Okay, so in your life, if you're feeling disconnected from God, it's probably because you're disconnected from his purpose. Francis Chan says it much more boldly than I do. Somebody came up to him after church one day and they said, Pastor, I am not feeling the presence of God in my life. And he said, well, are you making disciples? Because Jesus said, as you make disciples, I will be with you. Now, his presence is with you anyway, but you will sense his presence more when you are in his will and living out his purpose. So as you learn how to live within the kingdom of God, under the reign of Jesus, right, reading his words, emulating his life, applying his commandments, you will naturally delight in his presence. His presence is with us. This is a reality. And when we take his yoke upon us, we can learn how to live a life without lack, unconcerned and unworried, without fear, enjoying our relationship with Jesus. Okay, so that's it. R.E.A.D. We are going to read Matthew together this year.